Good evening and welcome to Colors Bigfoot Radio. It is September 9th, 2018, and you're here with your hosts, Lori Hood and Lauren Smith. How are you doing tonight, Lori?
I'm doing great, Lauren. How are you doing tonight?
Hi. He's been listening to me cough and hack for the last 15 minutes. I'm getting over it's been pretty bad. I have not held back while she's on the phone. Don't worry, I'll mute out if I have to do that tonight. But
thank you.
I'm doing good. Getting over a little cold, upper respiratory infection type thing. It happens every spring and fall because I live in Oklahoma, the land of pollen and weird weather. So I'm getting over it. My household's getting over it, you know, the usual. Yeah, I'll be all right.
They came last weekend and contaminated Mark. Now he has it.
And it's not contagious.
You say that, but I think that's awful weird that he has the same thing you've got, but it's not contagious. Okay.
Well, if allergies are contagious, then you would have them because you catch everything.
I know. So I guess that's it then. It's allergies.
Yep.
Okay.
I win. All right. Glad we cleared that little up, that little mystery. Xander has it, but Adam doesn't have it. So, So, just an update. Ricky just got back from hiking the Superior Trail in Minnesota. He hiked over 100 miles. He was going to hike 240 miles of the trail, but he came down real sick and had to call it early. He was super bummed out, but he still got to go. He still got to see some beautiful landscapes, meet a bunch of great people, and have a great time. He came back. He was, just real too sick to go on, or else he would have just kept trucking. He was trucking till his feet bled, but this illness that he got. So he's going to the doctor tomorrow to get tested. He doesn't know what it is. He looked it up, and he thinks it's the symptoms of Lyme disease. So he's going to go get tested tomorrow and make sure, verify whether it is or isn't. See what else maybe it could be. So, but
well, we're not claiming that in the name of Jesus.
We're hoping that that's definitely not what it is. But luckily, there's treatment for that. So, so we're all kind of sick in this house and maybe quarantined. Well, I'm just hoping it.
Uh-huh.
He said he did have tick bites, you know, but he didn't really pay any attention to him. And then about 6 days later that he really got sick. He had fever, ache, chills, vomiting, you know, just real bad. So anyway, so that's a health watch for the Smith house. And how about you? How are you doing?
I'm doing great, but I want to spray my phone with Lysol right now.
Well,
yeah.
I know that you're about to be retiring, so you'll have all the time in the world to Lysol away.
I tell you what, but it's been like a tractor pull, just like taking forever to get here. And, but it's, you know, it's about three more weeks, and then we're free. Freedom! Yes, I'm ready. I'm so ready. But, I'm excited that we're back on the air. I actually was really ready to come back. Most of the time I'm like, I'm not ready to, you know, but it's hard to get back into the swing of things again.
It is.
You know,
yeah.
It's like in the middle of the day I'll get a panic, go, we do have a show tonight, you know.
Yes, yeah.
You're used to not having one. And so it's like, I can't do that. I've got a show tonight, you know. You kind of prepare yourself all day. So, but I'm excited because we have got a lot of really good guests lined up, including tonight, but we have got a lineup of guests. And what is amazing to me is that, you know, sometimes when you ask these people to come on the show, they don't never have even heard of us. And they'll say, we'll go listen to the show and see if you're okay, and then we'll let you know, you know. And then they'll come back and say, okay, we'll do it, you know. But it seems like everyone that I've talked to this season has said, we listened to your show, we love your show. And I'm like, oh, wow, I like that. I like that.
Yeah, no kidding.
Yeah, I do. Oh, we listen to your show all the time. And yes, we would love to come on. And I'm just like, oh, yeah, I hope that keeps up the whole season, you know.
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
It is, you know, last season we had a couple that had never even heard of us. And, well, you know, I can understand that because not a lot of people listen to radio shows, you know. But then there are a lot that do. But some just don't. They're in their own, have their own thing going on, and they're just, you know, not interested in hearing what. It's kind of like me. I'm not a big book reader. You know, I have never read a big book. Never.
We're about to bring on an author of Bigfoot books, woman.
I know. So I hope you will not be offended if I have not read his book. But I never read them. You know, I feel, I don't know why I don't. Maybe I will have more time now that I've retired. So I probably have half a dozen books up there that have been sent to me. And I get to read them. And so I will definitely try to find time for that. So there's a lot of good information out there.
Hopefully, and I think part of your problem is you, no offense, but I think you just don't have the attention span to sit down and read them. And I honestly mean no offense to that. It's just that you're very busy. And I just don't.
Yes.
I think, you know, if it was an Audible version, then I think you would have a better success.
I don't know. You know, I used to read Stephen King all the time. I read every one of his books. Now, if I could sit down and read one of his books, I could sit down and read one of these. I think I was afraid that it would influence my research. And really, that is not the right attitude to have about it, because it's just, and I've learned that from these shows, that when you bring on researchers and they have their own methods and their own experiences, I've learned so much from these individuals that have come on our show. I'm telling you, it's a wealth of information out there coming from these individuals. So you can imagine if they've written a book, it would be the same thing.
Yeah.
So I really need to sit down and read these books, because even so, I may not agree maybe with something, you know. I may not, you know, always agree with the paranormal side. Doesn't mean that I can't read about it and see where they're coming from, at least be more open-minded. So,
right. That would be helpful,
but,
for sure.
Yes,
all right. Are
you
ready to get to our guest?
I am. I have never met this gentleman, and I'm anxious to talk with him. So, Lauren, if you would bring him on.
Okay. All right, DW, are you there?
Yeah.
All right. So, I'm going to call you DW because you asked me very nicely not to call you sir.
Yes. I know we're all old school, but. It just makes me feel like I'm even older.
I know. No, I just, it's how I was raised. But I'm really, really glad to have you on the show tonight. Really excited to hear about your history, the research, and the type of research that you do, because I got to witness it and I loved it very much. I was a big fan of the way you research, and as well as all the work you put into various events, your group, and the books that you've written. I'm very excited to have you tell us all about that.
Okay.
So how we usually...
Where do you want me to start?
So how we usually do it is we start from the beginning. How did you get into this topic?
Well, back in 1977, here in Oklahoma, we had an incident happened where a boy claimed to have gotten attacked by a Bigfoot. Mm-hmm. And it just so happened that it happened a mile through the woods from my house. And, you know, that really got me thinking about Bigfoot. And of course, it turned out that he actually lied about the incident. But, you know, it got my interest really riled up. And, of course, I found out later on down the road, I talked to one of the guys that actually investigated it, and he said, you know, look, Darren, this is the honest to God truth. The kid was actually using his neighbor's experiences to do his story with.
Oh, wow.
His neighbors were actually having that activity. You know, the Bigfoot were coming around the house and everything, and the kid just used that for the basis of his story. And I was like, holy cow. So, well, then I'm we went on, you know, and didn't really think much about Bigfoot in this area since it turned out to be a hoax. And, of course, I went into the Boy Scouts and then eventually went into the military. And I finally come back to my hometown back in 91, and I watched Legend of Boggy Creek, and I was like, well, crap, that's only about 2.5-3 hours down the road from me. So I went down there for a couple of days, you know, looking around and got my interest up. And then I come back, and about 4 or 5 years later, there was an incident here in my hometown that happened to me and my middle son. And of course, it happened to be that we thought we had something big walking behind us out in the woods there. So we went back the next day, and we found where something huge had jumped off of about a 10-foot bluff into a little gravel bank. And you could see the butt print. I mean, it made like 3 or 4 of my butts in the gravel, along with 2 footprints that was about 5 feet apart. And there was a little sapling that apparently it pulled it down and stripped all the leaves off of it and just sat there and had a snack. And then it stood up, and you could see where it walked off onto the gravel until it hit hard ground. And, you know, then we couldn't follow any more tracks. And so we started doing more and more digging. And before we knew it, we were pretty much doing full-blown Bigfoot research. And I had my first encounter about 1.5 years later. We were out ghost hunting at one of the cemeteries near where we were on Memorial Day. Mm-hmm. Matter of fact, I think I actually showed you that cemetery.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and that's where I had my first actual sighting at. So.
Really? Okay. You want to tell us about that? And I mean,
well, basically, we were out ghost hunting. The wife and the kids, they like to go ghost hunting. So we were out there, and we were taking pictures in the cemetery. And as we come out, I had my night scope, and, of course, my oldest daughter, she had a parabolic, and we started kind of walking across the little parking lot there, and we smelled like 4-week-old dead fish smell. And we were like, man, what the heck is that? And about that time, I seen a head and shoulders pop up over the bank of the creek, and I seen it in the night vision. And I was like, what the heck did I just see? And it lowered itself down, moved over a couple of feet, and come back up. And I seen it do that. And then it lowered itself down and went down to the creek and started running up through the creek. And she heard it with the parabolic. And it was like, holy cow, did I just, you know, it was one of those things. Crap, did I actually just see a Bigfoot? You know, what was that?
Wow.
And so, and then after that, we started digging more into that area and, you know, started having more and more stuff happen and more encounters. And so that whole area that we was in Memorial Day weekend was just a real active area. So,
man, it was. I know we didn't get a whole lot of action when we were there, when I was there, but I could tell that it was definitely a squatchy area. Well, that's a pretty good first encounter, I have to say. I think that'll do it.
And this is in northeast Oklahoma, DW?
Yeah.
Okay. That's kind of up there where Lauren is, too. You know, I've been canoeing over there on Tahlequah, and of course, back then when I canoed over there, on the Illinois, I never thought about Bigfoot at that time, but, you know, I thought back many a time that area probably is pretty squatchy.
Mm-hmm.
Seems like a good area for them. Has everything
yeah,
they
you
need.
Probably.
For sure.
Yeah, you probably canoed right by one of our main research areas. We have a research area right along the Illinois River, so.
Really? Wow.
Yeah. It's, go ahead.
I was just going to ask DW. So, DW, have you ever seen one?
Yeah, I've seen quite a few of them.
Okay.
We've actually got a white one in our area that I spotted on about four different occasions, and it's been spotted as far back as 96 here in the area. So.
Wow. Okay, and how I didn't mean to jump in, Lauren, but I just wanted to ask him this. How far apart were the sightings of this same individual?
Sometimes I'll go a year or two before I see him again.
Uh-huh.
The last time we seen him was a year ago, Memorial Day weekend.
Okay.
So, yeah, we actually seen him last year on Memorial Day. He actually crossed the trail in front of us. And then circled around us and come back across the trail behind us. It was a really wild encounter for everybody that was involved, because it's always been my experience that the Bigfoot always tried to get away from you as fast as possible. And this one actually circled around and made sure that we seen it as it circled around and then come back across the trail. And it was like he was trying to distract us, and we really think that, you know, maybe two or three of them was up there trying to bed down when we come up on them, and he was trying to distract us so they could get away. And I'll definitely say he did distract us, because we was really trying to go through the woods trying to catch up with him, and but he was moving so fast that I don't think I could have caught him even if it was all open ground. So,
well, I have a couple of questions about this individual. How tall was he, do you think, and was his hair long or short?
He's roughly around 7 and 7.5 foot.
Okay.
And his hair is not really long. It's, I would say, probably 4 to 5 inches long.
Okay.
But I have seen him between the V of a tree, and the night scope I used to see him with, I mean, he's not an old Bigfoot. I think he's just white because that's his color. But
yeah,
he's got the muscles and everything, so.
So do you think, with him being white, do you think that he could be albino, or do you think he's just going to be white, like a white cat?
I think he's just like a white cat, you know, that's just his color.
Yeah.
But, you know, I haven't got close enough to actually look at his eyes to see if they're red, you know, to be an albino.
Yes.
So,
yes.
I keep trying, though.
Lauren. Go ahead, Lauren. I'm sorry. I just can't back up. Go ahead.
I was just laughing at that. Well, you keep trying for us. Let us know, okay?
All right.
Oh, man. So I know that you've had a ton of different experiences. You've had your first experience at the cemetery. You've had your albino, or I'm sorry, white Bigfoot experience. And can you I know, can you tell us about any other sightings you have had? And if not sightings, then maybe some sticky situations you've gotten into.
Well, the one that was will probably always stick in my mind was what I call the Ape Parade. And this happened up north of Claremore. I would say it was probably 2007, 2008. Me and another researcher had went into an area that was highly active, and we backed my blazer up into the tree line of this field, and we run cameras out into the woods and had a generator out in the field in front of me. And it basically powered everything, all of our DVR and cameras and stuff like that. So I went and put a parabolic on the back of my blazer pointing down into the woods, and then I'm got the windows covered with blankets, so whenever I turn on the DVR to look and see what's going on, it don't really illuminate the blazer. So I'm sitting there, and I start hearing something walking up through the woods, and it's coming right up behind me, and it stops right behind the blazer, and I'm like, holy cow, what was that? And then just a few seconds later, here come another one walking up, stood right there behind the blazer. And then a third one come up. And I'm sitting there thinking, holy cow, you know, what's going on here? And then all of a sudden, it sounds like something reaches over with a big thumbnail and taps my parabolic bow. And, it, of course, it sounds like a gun going off.
Yeah.
So I'm sitting there. I got my camera, you know, and I kind of lower my blanket off of the window. I'm like, okay, if they walk around in beside the vehicle here, I'm going to, you know, get it on video. Well, as I'm sitting there waiting, I notice there's three or four what looks like hogs or maybe even cows going across the field in front of me. And I'm like, what the heck is that? And they get to the tree line, and they stand up on 2 feet and walk into the tree line. And, of course, my mouth just drops. I'm like, holy cow, what did I just see? And I'm sitting there thinking, okay, this is not going good because the other guy, he's at the other end of the field in his little trailer that he uses the research in. And I didn't know it at the time, but he's down there getting rocks thrown at his little trailer. So I'm sitting there, and all of a sudden here comes another group that looks like it's either hogs or cows going through there. They get to the same tree line and basically the same spot, and they stand up and walk in. And I'm like, holy cow, this is ridiculous. You know, that to me, that's like 11 Bigfoot in the area right there, you know. And so
happy
then I
birthday
see a third
to
group
you. Merry Christmas and happy birthday.
So then I see the third group come up, and they do the same thing. And, of course, I'm trying to listen in my headphones, and it sounds like they're coming down through where I got all the cameras at. And I'm like, oh, please let them walk in front of my cameras. Please let them walk in front of the cameras.
Yeah.
And then after they get past behind me, down by the creek, one at a time, those that was behind me turns around and walks back down to join the others. And I'm like, okay, what time is it? And I looked, and it was like 2 o'clock in the morning. I was like, okay, I ain't getting out until daylight. You know, they never got close enough for my camera, you know, to be able to pick up anything with the camera. But I'm pretty sure that if I would have stepped out while the three groups was going across, those three behind the blazer would have politely put me back in the blazer. So I think they were there to make sure that I didn't do anything to hurt the others. So
Man. And yet you still keep pulling back out. You are a brave soul.
Well, and there's always the, the four-wheeler incident that happened that, you know, a lot of people wonder why I keep going out after that, too, but I think you probably was told about that Memorial Day weekend.
Yes.
But
I would love to hear it again because all the stories that I heard Memorial Day weekend are worth hearing again. They were just phenomenal experiences. So.
Well, basically, a few years ago at the symposium, all of our researchers usually go down and camp where the Memorial Day expedition was and get in some research at night after we get done with the symposium. And a bunch of them wanted to go out and do a listening post. And we found that if we drive up through the valley there on four-wheelers and come back out just right after dark, the Bigfoot would come out behind us. And I think it's just to make sure that we're actually out of the valley. Mm-hmm. And so I was like, okay, y'all will go and walk up to the crossing there, and that's where you'll do your listening post. And I'll come through, you know, give them a head start. I will come through, go across the creek on my four-wheeler, and go up into the valley to a place we call a settlement, and then I'll turn around and come back out, and maybe they'll follow me right through the listening post. Well, I didn't make it that far. I made it to a little S in the trail about, oh, I'd say a mile into the valley. It's a six-mile valley. And as I come around the corner, there is two Bigfoot carrying a medium-sized calf on their shoulders down the middle of the trail. And all of a sudden, the back of my four-wheeler goes straight up into the air, and I just stopped cold turkey. And as I look over my shoulder, I see the hairy shoulder of a Bigfoot behind me, and he drops me down. And to this day, I still can't tell you how I turned around on that trail and made it back to camp. But when I got back to camp, they said I was nearly in shock. And I wasn't going to go back in until Compressor Mike, one of our researchers, was like, oh, come on, you big wuss. You know, we got to go back. You know, we got to go back.
Oh, he had to play card, did he?
Yeah, so it's like, okay, you get on the back. And we'll go back up in there. And when we got to where it all happened, they had laid a big old branch across the trail there. And so I'm like, okay, that says it all for me. They don't want us to go any further. And so the next morning, we're at the symposium, and the caretaker of the cattle herd right there nearby, he come in to the symposium, and I started telling him what all happened, and he got white as a ghost. And I was like, what's wrong? He goes, I'm missing a calf. So we actually got him on video where he said that he was missing a calf that next morning. So, and when I say calf, a lot of people think, you know, little baby calf, but for us country folks, you know, a calf is, you know, could be up to 600 pounds, you know, so.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, we actually looked at the back of the four-wheeler. It broke the welds on the bumper, and you could even see where the fingerprints of the hands were. Of course, at the time, nobody really thought about taking fingerprints, but it was all pretty much muddy fingerprints anyway, so.
Yeah. Right. That is the pretty terrifying experience, I have to say.
Yeah, so that's why now.
Oh, my God.
Yeah,
you know,
that's why
I
don't go back up into the valley without a GoPro going.
Yeah. I've had people say that to me. They go, how do you do it? How do you keep going out there, you know, when you have things? That I would have to say I have never had that experience. And I I just don't know that I would have kept going if I had had something like that. That's just... And you were by yourself completely, is that correct?
Yeah.
See? Number one, I would not have been out there by myself. I'm not like the Sisters of the Moon, you know, go out there all by themselves, you know. No. I believe in having, I always say this, it's my other witness. So if anything happens, I have someone who can, you know, say, yeah, I saw it too, you know.
Yeah.
But
yeah, this time was just one of those things where I was just going to run up there and run back, you know, and to be honest, I didn't think anything was going to happen. I didn't even hook up a camera or anything, so, you know.
Well, have you ever, well, you know, I know this is probably one of those times which you wish you hadn't put a camera on there, but I doubt it would have done you any good since it was behind you, but have you ever had a should have moment, you know, I wish, you know, like you left too soon, or you wished you had had your camera on, or, you know, one of those woulda, shoulda moments. Have you ever, I've got several, I don't even want to talk about, but do you have any of those moments?
Yeah, definitely the four-wheeler being picked up, I wish I would have had my GoPro going, because I could have at least got the two in front of me on the GoPro.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Not catching
your four-wheeler going up in the air. I mean, you had headlights
even
on.
Even a brake. Yeah, even a brake isn't going to pull your front end up.
Yeah. So, you know, Lauren was with us, and she seen, you know, we run with a GoPro on the front of the four-wheeler, and then the whoever's in the back even has a camera going. So,
yeah. I learned real quick, when you run with the MABRC, you don't pick your nose unless you're in the privacy of your own tent. Because there's always a camera running somewhere, and it will probably catch you in a moment that you don't want to be caught in. But honestly, I did have someone nicely tell me, careful where you go to the bathroom, because they have cameras around the camp, and for good reason, because how many of us have heard or experienced something walking through camp? So it's you know, a really good idea, but I was glad someone pulled me aside and told me, hey, by the way.
and we try to, you know, point the cameras to where it's not on anybody's tents or anything like that. We had a thermal that was running on the camp just about every night, because we have had the Bigfoot come through camp after everybody beds down. So what we like to do is, when everybody finally starts to go to bed, we throw a couple extra logs on the fire, and that way the Bigfoot can sit back a ways and see that, you know, nobody's around the fire, nobody's walking around. So, you know, we must have all turned in already.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, you know, Lauren was telling me, you know, that, you know, she was invited and to one of your events or expeditions. I'm not sure what you call them.
Yeah.
But she was telling me about how the protocol that you and your team put down, and the different things that you do, and the methods that you use. And I was actually very impressed. I have never, ever been out in the field with, well, other than Larry and Mark. They have methods too, but when, you know, when they're with all the rest of us, they're kind of more lax on it, maybe, or more, I don't know if lax is the right word. You know, we try to work as teams, but it's just kind of, you know, we all kind of do our own thing. And but with the MABRC, it seemed like there was more of a plan of action and definite duties and positions and making the most of your equipment. And
right,
there
was structure.
Yeah, structure, exactly. I'm not explaining it well. But I was just wondering if you would try to share with us some of the methods that you use out there when you have that many team members in place and all the equipment and everything.
Well, one of the things that we've really started focusing a lot on is using audio recorders. And,
yes, I agree with that.
One of the things about a lot of groups is they tend to stay close to their campsites, and we've decided that, okay, we can't really hear too much from the campsite about what's going on up in the valley and stuff like that. So we will stretch, you know, 6-7 recorders out along a 6-mile trail, and that way we are actually able to record further away from the camp. Now, this kind of goes back to our Project Silent Hills that we did, where we experimented how far we could hear wood knocks. And, you know, for most of us old-timers, you know, we'd hear a wood knock, and we'd be like, oh, that's a half mile away, you know. Well, after we did the Silent Hills project, we realized if you hear a real clear wood knock, they're within 100 to 200 feet from you. And then the sound degrades very consistently after that. 1,000 feet away, if a wood knock is made, unless you are really listening for it, you will miss it. So what we have decided is, okay, our recorders are going to do the work for us. They're going to listen for us, and we'll take them out there, and we'll drop those recorders. I think the weekend you was with us, Lauren, we put them like about every 1,000, 2,000 feet.
Yeah.
And, you know, they all basically, okay, if we hear this, did one of the other recorders hear it? You know, we can kind of
check.
Oh, I'm trying to think of, well,
back up.
We can say, okay, well, come from that direction because the other audio recorder caught it, you know, and then we can kind of move our recorders to better positions. We put the one recorder out there by that fallen tree. I don't know if you remember where that was located at.
Yes.
But that tree there, about 4 hours after we dropped that recorder off, picked up 10 different wood knocks within about I think it was like a 15-minute span. So I sent it over to Rebelistic, and he listened to it, and he was like, yeah, there's more than just one Bigfoot there because these are different knocks from different locations. So, you know, that was really an interesting thing to have happen to us out there.
Yeah.
So, and you know, it didn't happen to where any of us heard it that weekend, but you know, we got it, the audio recorded, and we was able to go back and listen to it and discover that. So that's part of our policies and procedures. You know, we go out there and we put it down on a map exactly where we're going to put them. We know where we're putting them, and then we can go and figure out, okay, are the Bigfoot coming through this area? Is there something in that area that they're preoccupied with? The recorder at the tree that fell was actually on a ridge above the settlement area that we call in the valley. And we've had lots of experiences with the Bigfoot down in that settlement area. So we thought, well, we're going to put the recorders along this ridge above it and see if we catch anything vocalization-wise. So, you know, our policies guide us on okay, you know, you do this. We go out there and you say the time, the date, the location. You put your recorder up. You let it start recording. And I don't know if you've seen the picture. I sent a picture of the Dropbox that I use. Get over to it.
Yeah.
It looks like a log.
Yep.
Oh, wow, that is neat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh.
We got a little rod that we can go up to a tree and hang it about 20, 25 feet up in the air, and people will walk right by without even know it's there.
Yeah.
So.
I always thought that they didn't seem to be too intimidated with audio equipment. I've even recorded them staking out the area. It's like they stayed in the area. I don't know why. Like to guard it. It's just this one area that they do this. And I haven't ever had it happen anywhere else. Just this one area. It's like once they discover the recorder, they decide to stay there. You just hear them kind of moving around, playing with a stick. You know, and no other animal is going to do that. They're going to move on, you know. And it sits there for hours. You know, you can tell by listening. You know, when you listen to a recording, a lot of times you have to use your imagination a little. But after a while, you kind of get a sense of what's actually going on. And those people that listen to recordings, they kind of begin to have an image of what's actually occurring. And so have you ever experienced that they kind of hung around the recorder? I know it's happened in other places here in Texas, but you know, with the Texas Bigfoot thing, or
I do know that we got hogs around here that, you know, they'll come into an area and then they'll hunker down for the night right by your recorder, and you know, you get all this activity. And you're like, oh, man, that's great, that's great. Well, I had the same thing on my recorder there at the tree where for 4 hours something is moving around, breaking sticks and stuff like that.
Uh-huh.
So I got all the information, and I sent it to Rebelistic, who is probably, in my opinion, is the best at listening to audio because he's listened to thousands of hours, and he can tell you if it's a hog or if it's a squirrel or if it's a Bigfoot. I mean, you know, he can tell you.
Yeah.
And he come back and said, nope, that's just regular wood noises. And I'm like, really?
Wow.
So, you know, so a lot of the stuff that people, I've actually been called an arrogant a-hole because people will send me stuff and I've got to be, you know, well, to be honest with you, you ain't got nothing there. And, so, you know, it's not that I'm trying to be arrogant. It's like Rebelistic. I've heard so much of it that I have to say, you know, well, trees do fall in the woods, sticks break in the woods, you know, stuff like that. And, of course, armadillos coming through sounds like a freaking herd of elephants, you know.
Oh,
so.
Yes.
But
deer will sound like bipedal, you know, because they are stepping in their back steps, or their back feet step into their front feet step.
Yeah,
I don't know how to say that, but you know what I'm talking about. And they will sound bipedal, and so when you think you've got bipedal footsteps approaching, you know, until it bleats or starts chewing on acorns, you don't realize it's a deer, you know?
Yeah. Well, it's just like our parabolics. We actually tell our new researchers, you know, that, hey, you get your new parabolic, you know, when they're first starting out, it's like, have your dog, somebody walk your dog back and forth in the backyard. If you got a goat, go listen to goats, go listen to cows. And eventually you'll start understanding how everything sounds on that parabolic. So.
Yeah, that's really good advice. You know.
Yeah, that's one thing that we do, you know, like those policies and procedures that you were asking about, you know, we also do a lot of training for our new researchers too, you know, and show them how to, we teach them the difference between a lot of different things.
Sorry, my husband was up here doing something. I don't know what he was trying. I was slightly distracted. I apologize. Okay. I have to ask you this. Have you ever experienced infrasound?
No. I'm not a believer in infrasound because I've got right up against Bigfoot before, and I haven't been hit by infrasound, haven't been never experienced cloaking.
Me neither.
I think we had to talk about that when I was up there.
Yes. No, I'm not a big proponent of a cloaking thing, but I have experienced infrasound. But have you ever had multiple equipment failure?
No, I sure haven't.
Okay. But you guys do go out in the woods at night, travel through the woods at night, doing night research?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, we actually went up on the high trail, and we went, it was roughly about 4 to 5 miles back in on the trail, and positioned everybody, it was roughly anywhere between 1,000, 2,000 feet along the trail, and we sit there for a while. And, of course, Lauren and Mark Newble, we had to drop them off, but they were right in the middle of everybody, so if anything would have happened, you know, we would have jumped on the four-wheelers and got to them. That's one thing we always make sure that we can get to our people if, you know, anything bad happens. So.
Yes. Yeah,
I really like the idea of sitting in a circle with your backs to each other's back kind of thing.
Yeah,
have 360-degree visibility of anything that might approach, audio or visually. I think that's a great idea.
That's what they did up there at the bus. But the one thing that I like to do is sit facing each other. And you're actually watching behind the other person across from you.
Yes.
Because, you know, if you're turned around looking out in the woods, the Bigfoot's going to be like, well, you know, screw that. They're looking out in the woods at us.
Yeah.
But if they think that you're sitting there just talking away, they'll get real close. We actually had that happen in Honubby where one got within 20 feet of one of our researchers, and the other researcher just happened to lift up a big old knife. Vision Generation 3 scope. About the time that the Bigfoot kind of leaned forward out of the tree line, and when it did, of course, it looked like it was right there in front of him, and he about went into hysterics because it's like, holy cow, they do exist, they do exist. Well, okay, just calm down. We thought we were going to have to bring him out of the mountains to the emergency room, so.
Gosh. I was going to ask you that, if you've ever had anybody totally freak on you. How do you go about calming them down?
Well, we've got a policy that we call it the bottle effect. If somebody is, their bottle is starting to fill up, they're starting to panic or whatever, that we want them to tell us, hey, I can't handle this no more. And if we see them starting to get to the point to where they're going to break, we'll quietly shuffle them back to camp. And, you know, we don't want to push anybody to stay out there past their comfort level. So,
you guys didn't tell me that. Y'all either forgot or y'all had tremendous faith in me, having been raised in the life. I call it.
You know, Mark was really laying it on thick that you was a cool customer when it come to being in the woods. So
he wasn't wrong. And I guess that's why I didn't get the you can wimp out talk, I guess. So that's all right. I take that as a compliment. That's good.
Well, you know, truthfully, though, if we would have seen that you were starting to panic or anything, but everything that I've seen, I was like, well, she can handle it, so.
Yeah. It really wasn't that, you know, there was only, I think, one time when I got a little freaked, and that was whenever Mark and I were alone on the trail, and I was scoping out something, and something landed right in front of me, like a rock or something big, you know, heavy landed right in front of me. And boy, I backed up so fast right on top of Mark. And then just, you know, but that was about the only time I got really that worried on the trail or on the whole expedition. When we were sitting in that clearing, things got really exciting, but I wasn't too scared. I was more just excited whenever we were doing the calls, and Debbie would do calls, and oh my gosh, it just like the woods lit up and came alive, and that was just so exciting for me, you know. Definitely more excited than scared. That's my mama's blood in me, I gotta say. I gotta give her full credit.
I don't know. I was an abusive mother. I made you stay even though you were ready to go home.
You did. It's like, oh, you can go hide the car. I'm going to stay here and have rocks thrown at me, you know. That's probably why I'm such a cool customer.
Yeah. Yeah, she's brain damaged, traumatized beyond.
I have an elevated fear, fear levels. I have elevated fear or decreased fear levels, maybe.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't think I really do. I think I'm just fine. Tell us a little bit about your books, if you don't mind.
Yes. Well,
I want to apologize in advance about what I said about books, not reading them.
That's okay.
Go ahead.
That's okay. For the longest time, when I first got into the research, there wasn't hardly anything that you could find book-wise about Bigfoot. Here about 3 to 4 years ago, me and my grandson, we started writing how-to books. And basically the how-to books were like how to do your own video analysis, how to do your own audio analysis. And it walks you step by step through using the software to do your own analysis and what to look for and stuff like that. We did one for territory markers. We did one for photographic analysis. And when I got those four books out, I decided to go ahead and do one about my experiences and stuff. And then we released a book here about 4 months ago, I believe it was. Get it down here off the shelf real quick. It's actually Starting Your Own Bigfoot Research. And it basically, it tells you, you know, okay, you're going to find the worst in people when you get into this community. You know, here's what to expect. You got to have a thick skin. And then it gives you, you know, the different steps of, do you want to just go out and have fun? Then you don't have to buy that much equipment. You can go out and just sit and listen. If you want to maybe prove that Bigfoot's out there, then, you know, you need to buy a certain bit more equipment. And then if you really want to do like the hardcore of us, you know, then you can buy this other equipment. And it just goes through steps of, for newbies, how to start their own research. And it even has quite a few things in there for the old timers that, you know, they may want to check it out and get some ideas from.
That must be about for me.
One of the things that it talks about is the cheapest way that you can do Bigfoot research is to get you a spool of thread and go out in the woods and run this across several trees in your area at a height of 6, 7, and 8 foot tall. And, you know, you come back in a couple of days and the 6 foot is broke, well, then, you know, you've got something up to 7 foot tall going through this area. And if the 7 foot one is broke, then, you know, it's 7 to 8 feet tall. And then, of course, if you find the all three of them broke, then you don't want to go back in that area for a while. So, because chances are you got a really big Bigfoot in the area. So.
That is good. Very inexpensive. I like that.
Yeah, you know, some people get into this and they'll spend $10,000-$20,000 for equipment just right off the bat, and then they really don't know. They don't know how to use it to do their research, or they go and. Well, for me, I specialize more in thermal imagery. Rebelistic, him and Mark Newble, they specialize in audio more. So, you know, you got to kind of find your place of what kind of research you want to get into. You just really can't get into everything and expect to be good at it. You really need to specialize on what you're doing in your research.
Are you saying that everyone has their niche, you know, their special thing
yeah.
they're really good at? Yeah.
Yeah.
I agree with that.
Because, yeah, Mark Newble, when he first started, and I'm not trying to pick on you, Mark, so. but when he first
started. He's a wonderful
started,
guy.
Yeah. When he first started, he came out with us several times, and, you know, he talked to everybody. He was trying to figure out what he wanted to do as far as the research. You know, did he want to do audio? Did he want to do video? You know, what did he want to do? And he finally settled on doing audio, and, you know, he excelled at it, and you know, I consider him one of the MABRC's experts on our audio, because him and Rebelistic and a couple other guys, they're the go-to people in the group, you know, when you do audio. So, but that's, you know, the way it boils down to. You got to find what you want to do as far as the research. Then you can spend just a little money. You know, you don't have to go out and spend $10,000-$20,000 to do the research.
Right. Have you ever had any luck with setting up, like, cameras, like little remote cameras, like up high in the trees, and they're hooked up to a television screen that you can monitor from a different location type thing? Have you ever done anything like that?
Yeah, we actually did a live feed at one point.
Kind of like
and,
a yeah.
Yeah, we did a live feed, and we ran it for, roughly 8 months. And to this day, I still have probably close to 20,000 hours of footage that I've got to go through.
Oh.
It's one of those things that we're now looking more towards the plot watcher cameras that takes a picture every minute. You know, we think we'll have more success with that if we camouflage them good enough. But as far as cameras in general, I pretty much gave up on those. the Bigfoot, I don't think that they know what a trail camera is, but I do think that they know that, okay, there's something on that tree over there that ain't supposed to be in the woods here, so they avoid it.
Yeah.
And the MABRC even goes to the point of we've got probably a dozen trail cams that we don't even put batteries in, but we'll go out on an expedition and we'll put it on three sides of the camp and leave the fourth side open. And the Bigfoot will always avoid those three sides and come in on the side that the cameras are not on.
Wow.
So,
that's a good idea.
Yeah, it's, you know, they see these cameras, and like I said, I don't think they know what they are, but there's a, all of a sudden there's a little box on the side of this tree, and, you know, hey, I don't want to go near that thing. So, and we put these trail cameras 25 feet up in the air and left them there for over a year, and you know, not able to get anything. So, you know, we're pretty sure that they just don't want to get around these cameras. You know, it's
I think that it discourages activity in that area as well. You know, I had one area that I was really having a lot of activity, and a friend of mine came and set up a couple of game cameras. And I still to this day don't know what he got. He got something on him, but I still don't know what he got. But I didn't have activity for a long time after that. It's like the trust was broken, or they just didn't want to come around. Their word didn't want to get snapped, you know. I don't know. I think if you want to get rid of them, that's a good way to do it. Just put some cameras out, a bunch of lights and things like that.
Well, I was down by Stigler, Oklahoma one time with three other researchers, and we were on top of this ridge line that overlooked this river down below us. And, of course, across the river was, you know, several thousand acres of woods. And we're sitting there in the middle of the night, and all of a sudden, the entire valley just lights up. And
whoa.
We're like, what the heck was that? Well, it was a trail camera that had got activated by a deer, but it was so bright that it lit up the entire place. So, you know, I'm pretty sure that the Bigfoot have, you know, they've watched deer set these things off, you know, and big old bright light, and they're like, yeah, we're not going to set that bright light off. So.
Have you ever researched in any other states other than Oklahoma?
Yeah, I've been to Texas, Arkansas, even been down to northern Louisiana, Missouri, Been to quite a few places. One of these days I might get out to the Pacific Northwest.
Oh, yeah, I agree. I'd love to try there. Did you, were you able to notice any differences in behaviors or anything different between the Sasquatch in one state versus another state?
Not really. I do know the ones here in the Oklahoma area are more aggressive, and we suspect that boils down to the fact that Oklahoma is one of the most acid rain states in the country right now, and it's because of all these coal generating plants, electrical plants that we have. They burn coal, and, of course, it gets up in our clouds, and it basically creates an acid rain. And when that rain comes down, the wildlife have been drinking it, and, of course, it pretty much makes them aggressive. You know, we've got deer that will basically try to take you out if they get a chance.
Oh, my goodness. I've never heard of this.
Yeah. you know, they tend to get aggressive, but, you know, the Bigfoot hasn't really, I don't think that they really try to intentionally hurt anybody. You just, quite a few times you'll get one that's in a really bad mood, and that's when you need to back off and let them have their space. So.
Well, it's just like with the Hanobi incident, and then there's been other stories, and it seems to me like they're extremely territorial, and my thoughts on that was that in Oklahoma that there may be that there is a loss of habitat or not much. You know, even though the eastern side of the state does have a lot of forests and mountains and fresh streams and stuff like that, it maybe there's just a concentration. So my thought was that they were just extremely territorial. Because like with the Hanobi incident, and I don't know if anyone out there has ever heard about it, but it was a family that was being terrorized by Sasquatch because of where they lived, and it was like the Sasquatch were trying to get these people to move, and apparently from the way the house looked, it had a siren on top and bars on the windows, and you know, I would have been thinking about, now why would this house have this? And then after moving into it and having these things start to happen, now you know why, but my thought about it, DW, is that they were territorial. So you don't think that's it? You think it's the rain? Or?
Well, as far as the Hanobi incident, basically what the Bigfoot were looking for was food. The people that own the property had put a snow pea field plot right behind their house to lure deer in so they could, you know, basically hunt the deer. And the Bigfoot had come accustomed to where every time they heard the gunshot, they knew that there was a wounded deer somewhere and, you know, hey, there's a free meal. Well, it got to the point to where they started shooting at the Bigfoot. And, of course, the Bigfoot are looking around like, you know, where's the you know, where's the deer at? And then after they actually started hitting the Bigfoot, that's when, you know, the whole thing changed. But I actually did a lot of research on the hillside up above where that all happened. And, you know, it's pretty something when you get back up in the hills back on the other side to the south there.
What's it look like back in there?
Oh, it's rolling mountains with ravines everywhere and creeks through them, and it's heavily forested. I mean, it's just real beautiful country back in there.
Appears to be there's a lot of places to hide, too.
Yeah, and see, the thing about Honubby is, and I tell this to everybody, you got millions of acres of woods down there, and people go down there thinking, oh, I'm going to have a Bigfoot encounter. Well, it's like looking for a needle in a haystack.
Yeah.
You got millions of acres, and you're not in the same area as the Bigfoot. I mean, it may be a month before they finally come back around to that area. So that's why we like our valley research areas, because it's compacted enough that the Bigfoot, they come through there roughly anywhere between 3 to 7 days. So, you know, chances are we're going to catch them when we're down in there. So when people ask me, you know, what about Honubby? That's the first thing I tell them is, you know, you're looking needle in the haystack there. So.
Yeah. I have done some research there in the Kiamichis, and it's just strange to me that I would get something. We'd actually get nothing.
seemed like nothing at all was going on. We would do calls. We got no responses, nothing like anywhere else we had ever researched. And then yet, you know, then you would get a random event, you know, like me being growled at when, but, you know, it could have been a bear growling at me, but
yeah.
I don't think so. And, of course, you know, that's the first time I've ever been growled at, and I was quite offended. But that was in the Kiamichis. We were on top of the mountain and camped out there, and I had gone back to my tent to get my recording equipment, and I was going to move it to a different area because we were hearing some call of some vocalizations off in another direction, and I wanted to put the bionic ear out that way. And when I walked back towards that tent, I got growled at by something in the woods there. So, but, you know, of all the times I've ever been there, that was the only thing that ever happened. And I'm kind of one of these people that likes to go and have something. You know, hear something, have something, have an interaction of some sort, walking around the tent, vocalizations, tree knocks, something. You know, but
yeah.
I feel like that every time I've ever gone there, it's just, there's just, I know they're there. I know they are, you know, but it's just, they're... There are so many places, and it's and another thing that really is advantageous to them is that they have the mountains. So, say they're on one side of the mountain vocalizing, you're not going to hear it in all directions like you would if you were down here in the piney woods.
Yeah.
And so it's just completely, it's blocked. The wind at night always picks up, and it's just a different thing. So, wow. Okay, so how long has the MABRC been? Did you join or did you create it or how did it come to be? Do you know?
Well, when I first started doing my research, I created Green Country Bigfoot Research Center,
mm-hmm.
which, you know, was really just all of us people here locally. And, then when I started presenting stuff on some of the message boards, other folks, you know, started wanting to join, and we kept getting more and more members in other states. And we're like, okay, well, we're not Green Country no more. You know, we're Mid-America, even though we had a few people in Washington and, you know, Oregon joined us. So we started it, and, of course, we also – put together our 7 golden rules, which governs the entire group. Basically, you don't go in another researcher's area without their permission. Everybody's entitled to their own opinion, and, you know, just
uh-huh.
mainstays that no matter what will never change. And we just kept having more and more people joining, and we're up roughly close to about 500 people across the country and the world.
Wow.
And, you know, there's a lot of our membership here in the Mid-America, and we actually had talked about changing the name of the group, and that kind of got voted down, and I was glad of that because it's like, crap, I don't want to change all of our logos and
yeah.
all that stuff. So.
Yeah. Wow.
But, yeah, it just continues to grow, and... you know, hopefully someday my grandson will stop long enough to maybe take over eventually. He's 16 now, so he's kind of interested in girls now and don't
uh-huh.
want to go back out in the woods at the moment.
Yeah.
So.
So are you still taking new members?
Yeah, we right now we've got roughly about 6 different applicants. We just got to get them interviewed, and you know, we have an interview process where we actually talk to them, and we kind of put everybody on probation. You know, for about 90 days, you kind of come on the forum and you interact with everybody, and you know,
uh-huh.
you're close to some of us. You can go out on the research stuff with us, and So overall, we've been pretty good about getting people in the group that are they have the same temperament as the rest of us.
Yeah. That's hard to do with 500 people, though, I would think. You know.
Yeah, it's.
Yeah.
Well, Lauren, we have less than 15 minutes, so I want you to talk to him. And I feel like I have hogged the guest as always. I do.
That's okay.
So I'm gonna be quiet.
I just wanted to touch on the symposium and kind of go over that. If you don't mind, I would definitely like to have you back on a little bit more closer to time. And we can discuss it closer in time as well so that you can, you know, kind of give a shout out. But, I was just wondering if you could kind of go over that a little bit.
Okay, yeah. We used to have it at the community building there in Stillwell. And, of course, we found the current location. It's called CC Camp. And it's actually roughly about 2 miles as a crow flies from where we was at Memorial Day weekend.
Oh, that's kind of perfect.
Yeah, it's a trying to figure out how to say it best. It's a building that's got a kitchen in it, and you know, bathrooms and showers. So some of us actually camp up there at the CC camp, and then the rest of us camp down at where the researchers are. But we have speakers come in. We have a large collection of casts that we show, and we even sell copies of casts.
Nice.
We have vendors coming in selling Bigfoot stuff. This last year, it's the second weekend of March, and this last year, we had a guy show up with a wooden cutout Bigfoot. He had some that was 8 foot tall and some that was 4 foot tall. And I'm actually sitting here in my office, and I got two of the big 8-footers sitting here looking down at me right now. But, you know, it's just a great event. I'll have all my books there at the next event. Hopefully even have a few more books from other authors there. So, you know, it's pretty much everything Bigfoot. We talk about research. We try to avoid having like Dr. Meldrum and celebrities show up. We want them to we want researchers there that actually talks about the research.
Right.
Hey, this is what I found, you know, this is what I recorded, this is, you know, what we do on this and that. And the response has been great. People just love hearing about the research.
Yeah.
So.
That's awesome. I mean, that sounds.
And
like
of course, it. We have Indian tacos there too. So. You know, people.
What?
there's some people that come in for the Indian tacos, and you know, then they stay and listen for everything else. So.
Oh, that's awesome. So is it like, do you do any expeditions afterwards?
On Saturday night, people can actually go down to the researcher camp, and some of our researchers will take groups out and do a listening post, and people can, you know, listen with, you know, they can borrow some of our parabolics and listen, and we show them what it looks like through a thermal, and you know, and then for the people that really want to come, that we feel would be able to handle it, you know, we'll invite those folks to come back and go out on an expedition with us. So
that's awesome. That's awesome. I like
so,
the,
you know,
'cause
some
the,
people.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
Because, you know, some people get out there on those listening posts, and then they start getting a little crazy, and it's like, yeah, we don't really want them out there with us again, you know, so.
Yeah. Oh, I can imagine. I can imagine.
Or, you know, you may get some out there that just won't shut up. It's out there.
Yeah.
Yeah. They wouldn't hear anything if it was right behind them.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's one of those, you know.
Definitely. Well, that sounds like a really good event that you got going. And, I mean, you said the word tacos, so I'm on board. I really am planning to be there, though. And I believe Cowboy.
What month is this in?
March. It's the second week in
March.
Oh, March. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Yeah,
if
so,
you said that, I didn't catch it. I apologize.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's not so far for me, and I'm really excited to be there. Hopefully I get to go. I can't wait to see the lineup and all the vendors you got going and everything. And, of course, you know, if I show up, if you needed help with anything, I'm down to help. Hopefully I don't sound like this.
We're always...
Yeah.
Well, you know, like I told you back there, Memorial Day weekend, you're always welcome to go out with us at any time. You don't really need an invitation from us. Just show up.
Well, I appreciate that very much. And I'm waiting as soon as you guys go out again.
Yeah, we're actually planning several expeditions. It's just trying to get everything lined up just right to make it work.
Oh, yeah. Time and money. I know. The Bigfoot researcher curse right there. I know it. I'm low on both of those, I'm really looking forward to researching with you guys again. Like I said, and I obviously told Mom, you know, over and over and over, how impressed I was with how you guys researched, how methodical and structured it was. I just really enjoyed that aspect.
They're set out to collect data. Yeah.
They have checks in place, you know, backups in place to double check themselves and to verify what they find and to keep out or keep any contamination or anything like that to a minimum, and I really appreciated that as well. So when I was invited to go out, I actually was sent the policies and procedures. And so at that time, I was like, first of all, there's policies and procedures. What? So I read these, and I'm going through there, and I'm like, at first I was like, what is this? What is happening right now? Because you have to think, like, I was in a less regimented, more laid back type of research. And so I get to the very end and I'm like, okay, I'm like, that's actually kind of cool that they have policies and stuff in place to, you know, say that if you're going to leave the campsite, make sure that someone knows where you're going at all times, you know, stuff like that. Just safety's in place to make sure that, you know, if there is action over here, it's not someone going off to go to the bathroom or that they know where you're at so that you're safe at all times. So they were actually really good policies and procedures all around. And so then when I got there, I was a little bit nervous. I was like, it's going to be a bunch of, military type guys. They're going to be all in camos and boots. I'm nervous. Oh my gosh, they're just going to be, you know, no sense of humor, boots on the ground. Here we go. No, I got there and they are actually the greatest group of guys. So nice. I brought my 5-year-old son with me and he is all boy and more than a handful. And not at one point did I feel like any of them were annoyed with him. They actually kind of helped me out, which I did not, I didn't expect, but they just kind of, you know, kept an eye on him. They kept him safe at all times. If anything were to have gone down out in the woods, he would have been safe. But they all had a great sense of humor. They were all hilarious, knowledgeable. Every single one of them has had experiences. They're knowledgeable. They're very knowledgeable about this topic, about their research. And when it comes down to going out in the field and doing business, that, you know, they're just very serious about it and scientific, and they mm-hmm. keep, you know, the data straight, they keep the evidence straight, and I just appreciated that so much and have so much respect for this group. So appearances can be deceiving. You know, whenever I got that first little tidbit about the policies and procedures, I was intimidated for sure, but going out with them and seeing why they do it the way they do is it just it totally uh-huh. I really like the way they research. It's a great group. You guys are doing great things out there.
appreciate all the comment or all the compliments. You know, the thing about the bathroom, just as an example, we were down by Idabel one time, and there was five of us on a little investigation down there, and we were down on one of the rivers way back in the back of the woods, and one of our guys had to go to the bathroom, and he told us, you know, I'm going to the bathroom. So we're sitting there, and I'm talking to one of the other researchers, and I see this head pop out in the woods to the south of us, probably about 250 feet away. And I'm like, oh, okay, well, that's Dave over there using the bathroom. So we're sitting there, and about 5 minutes later, Dave comes walking from the other direction. And I'm like, Dave, did you go over there and use the bathroom? He goes, no. And I'm like, crap, that was a freaking Bigfoot, you know, peeking around looking at it. So, you know, that there's reasons for these policies, because, you know, if you're going to go use the bathroom, you know, and if you're a female, you don't want a guy walking up on you. Yeah, but, you know, we're sitting there, and we see a head pop around something. Well, if we know which direction you went in, then we can say, okay, there's something over there, and we need to go check it out. So,
yeah, definitely. No, we know there's a reason for your madness. We get it. I just really respected the whole thing. It was just a really – I had a great time. I learned a lot. I definitely look forward to going back out with you guys and learning even more.
And if your mom ever gets up this way, and she can go with us too. So.
Oh!
Well, I was just waiting to get invited. I wasn't going to go, can I go? I would love to go. I would. I would try. I read the rules and regulations before I go, too, even though I'm not a big reader. I'll read that book.
I think she'd be just fine. The only thing is, actually, she's pretty good out there. She's just more lax about it. You know, she's more relaxed, and she likes to talk to Bigfoot.
I do like the recording. That's what I do. That's my deal is audio.
Yeah. She and
I just have to figure out where everybody else is and just tell me where you want me to set up, and I'll just go set mine up, too. Oh, my goodness. It has been really great talking to you, I've been seeing you on the internet ever since I've been in this, 18 years. And I've been seeing you out there in the MABRC, and y'all have been around a while. And so anyway, you know, it's so good to actually get to talk to you. I hadn't ever really, I don't think we've ever communicated in the whole 18 years. So it is good to get to talk to you and to hear more about you and everything. And we definitely want to have you back in February. That way, if we have you back in February, that way it'll give you plenty of time for us to get the word out about the symposium and tell people to go. Yeah,
that'd be good.
Well,
all right. We definitely appreciate you coming on tonight so much.
Yes. It was a great interview. We really enjoyed it very, very much.
Thanks for being our first guest back on.
Yes.
You're welcome.
Your first guest of the season.
Yeah.
So it was really great to have you on, too.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I guess we're going to have to wrap it up at the show. And
it looks like it's already stopped recording.
Yes, it has. For those that are listening, now next week I believe we're having Shane Church. And so Shane Church will be our guest next Sunday. So everyone tune in. And I hope that y'all have a wonderful week and happy squatching, everybody. Everyone say good night.
Good night.
Night.
Good night.
Night Callers, Bigfoot Radio.